Beach Boys are a fascinating band in that pretty much everyone knows they exist, but very few know much beyond the surface. Everyone knows hits like Surfin' USA, Wouldn't It Be Nice, and Kokomo, but the average person probably doesn't know anything about the band beyond Pet Sounds and Greatest Hits compilations. This is noteworthy because the more research you do on the history of this band and its members, the more you realize the Beach Boys might actually be one of the weirdest, most eccentric bands of all time. I have found four different icebergs on the Beach Boys subreddits, and I will be using a combination of all four in this iceberg video. I'm covering pretty much everything. I will only be omitting entries that I feel are irrelevant or just spooky meme entries. In the corner of the screen for each entry, I will have a scale based on how well I know said topic, with 5 music notes meaning I am fully confident in what I'm saying, and 1 music note meaning it's just a shot in the dark and I'm just guessing. Anyway, there's a lot of information to cover, so let's get into it. The Wrecking Crew. The Wrecking Crew were a group of talented session musicians who worked in Los Angeles in the 1960s. They performed on several top 40 hits of the time, most notably being used for Phil Spector's Wall of Sound, which was one of Brian Wilson's biggest musical inspirations. Wilson utilized the Wrecking Crew on Pet Sounds and many of the original Smile sessions. The band rejecting Pet Sounds. Mainly Mike Love. Love has been quoted as supposedly saying, "Don't F with the formula," and he worried the album was too artsy and it didn't have enough pop hooks or upbeat lyrics to be a massive hit. Supposedly the album even got its name due to Love saying something along the lines of, "Only the ears of a dog will hear this." Brian cared more about making good music, while Mike cared more about having a hit record. Supposedly Al Jardine's initial reaction to hearing the new material wasn't positive either, but it quickly grew on him. Live Aid. The band performed at Live Aid, the benefit concert to raise funds for the famine in Ethiopia, on July 13, 1985. All 6 of the core members were present at this performance, except for Dennis, who unfortunately passed away 2 years earlier. They performed California Girls, Help Me Rhonda, Wouldn't It Be Nice, Good Vibrations, and Surfin' USA. Brian's Envy of Spector. Brian had an obsession with Phil Spector's Wall of Sound production style, and would often try to replicate it in his mid-60s works. He was particularly obsessed with the Spector-produced Be My Baby by the Ronettes, to the point where at one point in the studio he had a tape loop of just the chorus made, and he listened to it for several hours in a trance. Hang On To Your Ego. Hang On To Your Ego is the original title for the song I Know There's An Answer off Pet Sounds. The original lyrics featured more explicit references to LSD, which Brian had been experimenting with at the time. Mike Love refused to sing these lyrics, as he believed they were encouraging drug use, although Brian has said the lyrics are meant to portray the negative side of using LSD. Despite this, Brian changed the lyrics to avoid controversy, and the new lyrics became I Know There's An Answer. Despite the lyric changes, drug references are still present in the new lyrics, such as they trip through the day and waste all their thoughts at night. Smile. Smile was the intended follow-up to Pet Sounds, originally planned to be released sometime in 1967. The album was meant to be a concept album that centered around 1800s Americana, such as the psychedelic Western Heroes and Villains, or the incorporation of standards such as The Old Master Painter and My Only Sunshine. The album featured influence from many genres such as psychedelia, jazz, classical, ragtime, musical comedy, and music concrete. Unfortunately, due to a variety of factors, such as Wilson's declining mental health and struggle with drugs, Mike Love's disapproval, and Van Dyke Park's departure, the album was never finished. In its place, the band recorded Smiley Smile, which features several reworked songs from the Smile Project, but with a more stripped-down, lo-fi minimalist feel, as Smiley Smile was recorded in just a few weeks at Wilson's house. Several unfinished songs from the Smile Project were also reworked for later Beach Boys albums, and we'll get more into that later. There are 2 official versions of Smile. One was in the 2004 Brian Wilson Presents Smile, in which Wilson re-recorded his ideas for Smile from the ground up and finally created a finished, albeit compromised, version of the original album. And the other is 2011's The Smile Sessions, which was released by Capitol Records and follows a similar structure to Wilson's 2004 re-recording, but made up of the original Smile recordings from the 60s. Competition with the Beatles. In the mid-60s, the Beach Boys and Beatles had a friendly rivalry in terms of songwriting. Notably, Brian Wilson heard the American version of Rubber Soul and was blown away how every track is good and how the album flows so well, so he declared that he would one-up them by making the greatest album of all time, and this resulted in Wilson making Pet Sounds. The Beatles, particularly Paul and John, would end up being blown away by Pet Sounds, and wanting to take the concept album idea to the next level, created Sgt. Pepper. The animal sounds at the end of Good Morning, Good Morning off Sgt. Pepper are meant to be a nod towards Pet Sounds. Brian's December 23rd panic attack. Due to a rigorous touring schedule, Brian had a panic attack on board a flight from LA to Houston on December 23rd, 1964. Because of this, Brian stopped touring live, and this would eventually lead him to recording Pet Sounds with the Wrecking Crew while the rest of the band were on tour. Bruce Johnston joined the band in 1965 to replace Brian on tour, and this led to him becoming a permanent addition to the band. Love and Mercy. Love and Mercy is the 2014 film directed by Bill Pullen. The film is a biopic about Brian Wilson, focusing specifically on both him making Pet Sounds and Smile in the 60s, and his experiences with Dr. Eugene Landy, who we'll get more into later. Oftentimes, music biopics can feel cliched and skew facts for the sake of a story arc, but this was actually a really good movie, and I'd recommend if you're a fan of the band. God Only Knows is Paul McCartney's favorite song. Paul McCartney has praised Pet Sounds and Brian Wilson on numerous occasions, and has said that God Only Knows is one of his favorite songs of all time. Man's got good taste. As a bonus fact, Paul McCartney and Brian Wilson were born just 2 days apart from each other. Brian Wilson's 3 years in bed. Around 1973 to 1976, Brian went through a period where he spent almost all of his time reclused up in his room. The idea that he literally spent all day in his bed is a bit of a misconception, as it's reported that he'd often go out and party all night, then sleep and stay in bed all day. During this time, he partook in excessive amounts of drugs and junk food. This reclusive period is what caused Eugene Landy to be brought in 1975. More on him later. Dennis was the only surfer. Despite writing numerous songs about surfing in their early days, Dennis was the only member who surfed regularly. He initially had the idea to write surfing songs because it was the hot new craze, and it kept up because, well, as Mike said, don't F with the formula.
You're a phony! This guy's a great big phony!
Surfer Girl was Brian's first song. Brian claims that Surfer Girl was the first song he ever wrote, even before the song Surfin'. He claims he wrote it when he was 19 years old, basing the melody off the Disney song When You Wish Upon a Star, and harmonies inspired by the Four Freshmen. Despite this, it wasn't released until their third album in 1963. Original band names. When the band was first forming in 1961, their original name was the Pendletones, a pun on Pendleton shirts, combined with tone. Kind of like a certain other group whose name was a pun between a common word and a musical term. When the band released their first single, Surfin', through Candix Records, promoter Russ Reagan changed the name to the Beach Boys, and the rest is history. Supposedly another name suggested in the early days was Carl and the Passions, and this name was paid homage to on their 1972 album. Rented Instruments. The iconic story to how the band first got their instruments has many conflicting accounts. The story often told is that Murray and Audrey Wilson took a vacation to Mexico City, leaving the Wilson brothers home alone, and left them some money for takeout or groceries. The brothers instead used this money to rent instruments, which they used to rehearse their first song, Surfin'. Details such as how much money and how long the vacation was vary, and Al Jardine claims his mother loaned them the money for the instruments, so it's unclear if this story has any truth to it. Brian is deaf in his left ear. Due to a physical injury in his childhood, Brian is almost completely deaf in his left ear. This is why in the 60s he always mixed in mono, as he cannot hear in stereo. The exact incident that caused his deafness is unclear, as some reports say Brian's abusive father struck him with a 2x4, while others say a kid struck him with a lead pipe while he was playing in the neighborhood. Al Jardine's temporary leave. Although Jardine was one of the founding members of the band, and he played double bass and sang backup on their first recording, Surfin', he left the band in 1961 to become a dentist. After his departure, he occasionally filled in for Brian live on bass, and he fully rejoined the band in 1963 as a rhythm guitarist after David Mark's departure. Murray Wilson gave the band fame. Murray Wilson, father of the Wilson brothers, although abusive and manipulative, was arguably responsible for the Beach Boys' early success. He was the group's manager, and his tough negotiating got the band a contract with Capitol Records. Paul McCartney on Vegetables. During the recording of Vegetables for Smiley Smile, Paul McCartney was invited to the studio, and he ended up performing on the song. So, did he sing a backing vocal? Did he lay down a bass line? No. He played the celery. Yes, he rhythmically chomped celery, and you can hear this on the Smiley Smile version of the song. Dennis's Surf's Up songs. Dennis Wilson penned two songs for the Surf's Up album, 4th of July and Wouldn't It Be Nice to Live Again. These songs were left off the album due to the band wanting to be more egalitarian with their songwriting, not wanting too much of the album to be taken up by the Wilson brothers' compositions. Dennis had plans to save these songs for a solo album, but this never ended up happening. It's a shame they were left off the album because these are really nice songs. Considering Surf's Up's only 10 songs, I don't see why they couldn't have included these two songs in addition to what was already on the album and just make it 12 songs. Or just get rid of Student Demonstration Time because that one sucks. Mount Vernon and Fairway. Mount Vernon and Fairway is an EP that came packaged with the Holland LP in 1973 and was composed by Brian. The EP is a musical fairy tale featuring narration from manager Jack Riley. It tells the story of a prince who finds a magic transistor radio with the voice of the Pied Piper. It was heavily inspired by Randy Newman's Sail Away. Smiley Smile as an LSD comedown album. Apparently, Smiley Smile had positive effects regarding LSD comedown, and some drug clinics have even utilized the album to help patients come down from bad trips. Personally, although I've never done LSD, I feel like songs like Fall Breaks and Back to Winter and She's Going Bald would not be pleasant while having a trip, but I suppose there are parts of the album that have more calm, soothing moments that could help one come down. Little Bird is Childish Father. Little Bird is a song written by Dennis for their 1968 album Friends. For the outro of the song, Brian contributed a reworking of his song Childish Father of the Man, which had planned to be on the scrapped Smile. Brian's songwriting contributions to the song were uncredited. Smile acetate mixes. In 2013, Van Dyke Parks' ex-wife, Duri Parks, put up a listing for 8 Smile acetates, and they were sold to a collector. These acetates contain alternate versions of Cabin Essence, Do You Like Worms, Wind Chimes, and Heroes and Villains that were not featured on the Smile Sessions box set. Unfortunately, the buyer has not made these recordings public. Trombone Dixie. Trombone Dixie was an instrumental track recorded during the Pet Sounds sessions. It was left off the Pet Sounds album, but became available in later reissues, such as the 1997 Pet Sounds Sessions box set. Reportedly, Brian was messing around with the musicians in the studio, and he pulled this arrangement out and they knocked it out in 20 minutes. The melody bears resemblance to their previous song, The Little Girl I Once Knew. Part of the song would later be reworked into 1976's Had to Phone Ya off 15 Big Ones. Add some music / reverberations. These are working titles for the band's 1970 album, Sunflower. The band sent their album Add Some Music, which featured a slightly different track listing from the final Sunflower album, to their new label Reprise Records, but they rejected this track listing, believing there was no radio-friendly hit on this version of the album. Then, in April 1970, the band sued their previous label Capitol Records for royalties, but found they still owed one more album before the contract expired. They assembled another alternate track listing, this time called Reverberations, and accounts are unclear on whether Capitol rejected it or whether the band had second thoughts. Capitol ended up releasing the album Live in London in 1970 to fulfill the final album obligation. Brian's back. When Brian returned to touring and producing in 1976 after his 3-year hibernation, a media campaign called Brian's Back was devised to promote his return. Mike Love even wrote a song about it on the Endless Harmony soundtrack. It's cheesy as hell, but also it's a bit heartwarming. The Help Me Rhonda session. This refers to an infamous tape of the band recording their 1965 hit Help Me Rhonda, in which a drunken Murray Wilson takes control of the session, and this results in arguments and abusive melodrama unfolding between Brian and his father. Murray tried to stop the recording, but Brian insisted it gets captured on tape, and the recording pretty much confirms Murray's abusive behavior. The full 40-minute recording is on YouTube if you're interested. Eugene Landy. Eugene Landy was a therapist hired in 1975 and then again in 1982 to help treat Brian's mental health problems, drug abuse, and weight gain. He was notoriously abusive, over-medicating Brian, keeping him under control and surveillance 24/7, and tried to piggyback off his patient's success by taking songwriting credits on his compositions, such as on the Beach Boys' 1985 self-titled album, as well as several tracks on Brian's solo debut. This is only scratching the surface of Landy's abuse. I suggest doing further research if you're interested. Environmentalism in Surf's Up. In 1970, then-manager Jack Riley suggested writing more political songs to stay relevant. Because of this, Mike Love and El Jardine wrote Don't Go Near the Water, a song that contrasts the band's upbeat early hits about surfing by saying you should stay away from the water due to the pollution. It's worth noting that Mike Love has always been passionate about environmental issues. Reggie Dunbar. Reggie Dunbar is a pseudonym used by Murray Wilson. Murray contributed lyrics to the Brian-arranged single Breakaway and was credited as Reggie Dunbar. The single unfortunately did not find much success and is one of the few Beach Boys singles not included on an album. Run James Run. This is the original title of the instrumental track Pet Sounds off the album of the same name. This original name was given because Brian wanted the song to be used as a theme for a James Bond film, but this never ended up happening. The Sandbox. Sometime in the mid-60s, Brian had a sandbox built in his house and put a piano in the sandbox so he could feel the sand on his feet as he composed. Surf City. In 1963, Brian met surf rock duo Jan Berry and Dean Torrance at a party. He played the duo Surfin' USA on piano, and the duo asked if they could record it as a single, but Brian refused, saying it was made for the Beach Boys. Brian instead suggested they record his song Surf City, which was unfinished at this point. Jan and Dean finished the song and recorded it as a single, and it went to number one in 1963, becoming the first surf song to be a number one hit. This reportedly made Murray Wilson angry, as the Beach Boys did not have a number one hit at this point, and he believed if the band recorded Surf City, it could have been their first number one. Meanwhile, Brian was just happy to have written a song that became a number one hit. Full House appearances. Brian, Carl, Mike, Al, and Bruce appeared on the 1988 Full House episode, Beach Boy Bingo, where they performed Kokomo and Barbara Ann. Mike and Bruce also appeared on the 1992 episode, Captain Video Part 1, performing Forever alongside John Stamos. Stamos actually had connections to the band even before starring in Full House, with him occasionally playing percussion live with the band in early 1985. He even appeared playing congas in the Kokomo music video. The Little Girl I Once Knew. The Little Girl I Once Knew is a single released by the band in November 1965, shortly after the Party album was released. The song was recorded early on in the Pet Sounds sessions, and is notable for featuring long pauses of silence between the verses and choruses. Many radio stations were hesitant to play the song due to the pauses, as they feared the dead air time would cause people to change the stations, and as a result, the single was not very successful. It is one of the few Beach Boys singles to not appear on an album, and as a result, many fans overlook it. The Beach. Around the making of Sunflower, Brian suggested the idea of changing the band name to simply The Beach, as they were no longer boys, and he wanted to distance the band's new artistic direction from the simple teen songs of their early career that had fallen out of fashion in the later half of the 60s. The band rejected this idea, mainly because it could confuse fans of the band. Brian Loves You. The band's 1977 album, The Beach Boys Love You, was originally planned to be a Brian Wilson solo project called Brian Loves You. This album was to be something of a drug rehabilitation project for Brian. There are bootlegs of the Brian Loves You demos out there on the internet. Adult Child. Adult Child was the intended follow-up to the band's 1977 album, Love You, and was more or less a Brian solo project. The album featured several big band Sinatra-inspired tracks, such as the first track, Life is for the Living. The label ended up rejecting the album, and the band ended up following up the Love You album with MIU album instead. Though the album has never been officially released, it is widely available through bootlegs. Sweet Insanity. Sweet Insanity was a Brian Wilson solo album planned to be the follow-up to his self-titled solo debut, planned to be released in 1991. Brian has said the original masters were stolen, preventing an official release, although in 2015 Brian said they scrapped it after recording it because they felt it wasn't very good, so it's unclear which is correct. This album was written while Brian was under the control of Eugene Landy, and he was the main collaborator on this album. The recording sessions for this album have been described as uncomfortable. Though this album has never been officially released, it is widely available through bootlegs. Charles Manson. Believe it or not, Dennis Wilson had a brief and strange friendship with Charles Manson a year before he went on his killing spree. In 1968, Dennis picked up two hitchhiker girls who happened to be followers of Manson. This led to Manson meeting Dennis, and the two ended up hitting it off, possibly because Manson offered free acid and women. Manson and his female followers moved into Dennis's home for a few months, but eventually Dennis got fed up with their antics and their high cost of living, so, scared of directly confronting Manson, he moved out of his rented home, forcing the landlord to evict Manson's crew. Part of the reason Manson connected with Dennis is because he had dreams of becoming a musician, and he was able to get in contact with industry insiders and make some recordings with Capitol Records during his time with Dennis, which leads us to Cease to Exist, Never Learn Not to Love. During Manson's time with Dennis, he penned the song Cease to Exist with the intention of the Beach Boys recording it. The song was used on the 2020 album under the title Never Learn Not to Love. The lyric Cease to Exist was changed to Cease to Resist on the Beach Boys version, possibly because the line Cease to Exist was seen as too dark. Supposedly Dennis was threatened by Manson because of this lyric change, and this is partially what caused the friendship to end. Dennis was credited as the writer of the song, as Manson sacrificed his writing credit in exchange for some money and a BSA motorcycle. Mike Love has said that he was not aware Manson composed the song and assumed Dennis wrote it. Fun fact, between Manson, Phil Spector's I Can Hear Music, and Leadbelly's Cotton Fields, there are three murderers or attempted murderers who contributed to the composition of the 2020 album. Pretty dark stuff. The original Smile Sleeves. Supposedly sometime in 1966 or 1967, Capitol Records printed some first edition sleeves for the upcoming Smile album, with the assumption that the album would be coming out soon. I couldn't find too much info about this, but supposedly one sold for auction at one point. I haven't seen the back cover of this official sleeve, and as far as I know, the official track listing had not been decided by this point, so I'm unaware how they would have written the track listing. Can't Wait Too Long. Can't Wait Too Long is a previously unreleased song written by Brian. It was recorded in 1967 and 1968, after the Smile sessions had already finished. The lyrics were pretty simple and repetitive, with the phrase "Can't Wait Too Long, Baby" repeated several times, but the track features some intricate and beautiful vocal harmonies. The main section of the song features an interpolation of the bass line from the Smile song Wind Chimes. It has been released in some form or another on several compilations, such as a bonus track on the 1990 Smiley Smile Wild Honey combo release, and on the 1993 anthology Good Vibrations 30 Years of the Beach Boys. David Marks. David Marks is the rhythm guitarist who joined the band during Al Jardine's temporary departure in 1962. He played rhythm guitar on the band's first four albums. Despite this, he is often overlooked as being a member of the band due to his early departure. He left the band in August 1963 due to problems with then-manager Murray Wilson, and this is what resulted in Al Jardine returning to replace him. Marks would later go on to front the group The Marksmen, as well as doing work as a session guitarist. Bamboo. Bamboo was a solo album recorded by Dennis in 1977 to 1979 and was intended to be a follow-up to his solo debut, Pacific Ocean Blue. The album was never finished due to lack of funding and Dennis focusing on other Beach Boys projects. Two songs from the sessions, Love Surrounds Me and Baby Blue, were reworked on Beach Boys' 1979 album, LA Light Album. In 2008, the unfinished tracks were compiled as bonus tracks on the CD release of Pacific Ocean Blue, and then in 2017, these tracks were released as the standalone release, Bamboo, The Caribou Sessions. Monterey Pop Festival, 1967. The Beach Boys were scheduled to headline the Monterey Pop Festival in June 1967, but at the last minute they pulled out. There are many theories and exclamations as to why this happened. Some people believe the band thought they would seem dated and out of touch compared to other headliners such as Jimi Hendrix, The Who, and Jefferson Airplane, who had far more psychedelic and/or hard rock sounds. The official exclamation from the band is that Carl's military draft was taking place during the festival, and that they were worried about getting arrested if they appeared on stage. Some believe the band's absence from this festival contributed to their steep decline in popularity in the late 60s. Radiant Radish. In 1969, Brian Wilson opened a store called The Radiant Radish, which specialized in health foods, vitamins, and supplements. Brian could often be seen working there in a bathrobe. In 1970, the store filed for bankruptcy due to lack of profitability and Brian's lack of business knowledge. Temporary split. As far as I can tell, the band have never split up, but I have found discussions about times where inner turmoil in the band caused the idea of splitting up to arise. Supposedly, there were times during the Smile sessions, and in the late 70s after Love You, where arguments within the band caused the idea of splitting up to be brought up. And fun fact, the Beach Boys are actually the longest running band of all time. They've been going for over 60 years now. Kenny and the Cadets. Kenny and the Cadets was something of a side project in 1962, composed of Brian, Carl, and Al, along with the Wilson brothers' mother, Audrey Wilson, and Val Pulito. In 1962, during the Beach Boys' brief contract with Candix Records, producer Bruce Morgan had these five sing over instrumentals of two songs he composed, Barbie and What Is a Young Girl Made Of? These songs would be issued as a single in 1962 under the name Kenny and the Cadets. Interestingly, this was during the time when Al Jardine technically was not a member of the Beach Boys, but he provided vocals on this project. Jack Riley's importance. Jack Riley was the band's manager in the early 70s, and he is often credited with steering the band in the right direction during this time, giving them the confidence to make Surf's Up and Holland. He also contributed lyrics on some songs off these albums. He did have his downsides, as he could be dishonest and fraudulent, such as falsely claiming he won a Peabody Award and Pulitzer Prize. However, he did help elevate the band after what was one of their lowest points commercially, so he definitely deserves some credit. Kokomo's success. After having little commercial success in the 1970s and early 1980s, the band suddenly achieved their fourth and final number one hit with 1988's Kokomo. This success was likely because it was attached to the successful film Cocktail, and nostalgia may have also played a factor. During the late 60s and early 70s, not enough time had passed for nostalgia to set in, so the band were likely seen as has-beens compared to the new rock music coming out. But by the time Kokomo was released, the band had been making hits for over 25 years, so the original fanbase were older and nostalgic of when the band first was big. Never underestimate the power of boomer nostalgia. The Element Suite. The Element Suite was planned to be part of the Smile album, with a song for each of the four elements, Earth, Wind, Fire, and Water. It's possible Brian's original version was different from the Smile Sessions version, but from what we have, it seems that Vegetables represents Earth, Wind Chimes represents Wind, Miss O'Leary's Cow represents Fire, and Love to Say Dada represents Water. Brian on the 2020 Inner Gatefold. Brian did not appear on the front cover of the 2020 album. This could have to do with him being absent for most of the recording due to being in psychiatric care at a hospital. However, he does appear on the Inner Gatefold of the album, standing behind an eye chart. Differences in Smiley Smile and Smile songs. Several songs from the Smile sessions were reworked onto Smiley Smile, but many of them feature completely different recordings and arrangements. Heroes and Villains and Good Vibrations are two Smiley Smile songs most similar to their Smile counterparts, with Heroes and Villains being more or less the same besides missing the Cantina bridge and extended outro on Smiley Smile, and Good Vibrations having an extended bridge on Smile. The other Smile songs, Vegetables, Wonderful, and Wind Chimes, have completely different arrangements on Smiley Smile, featuring minimalist lo-fi renditions as opposed to the Smile versions, which featured the Wrecking Crew and dense vocal harmonies. The Smiley Smile song, She's Going Bald, also features the melody from Smile outtake, He Gives Speeches. The Teepee. I'm not exactly sure what this refers to, but I believe it's referring to how in addition to having a sandbox in his living room, Brian had a tent or teepee in his living room, which he would often smoke pot in. Pet Sounds Leftovers. Along with the previously mentioned Hang On To Your Ego and Trombone Dixie, there were also sessions for Good Vibrations recorded during Pet Sounds. However, the song was not finished yet, and would instead be finished and released a few months afterwards. The Pet Sounds Sessions box set contains various alternate takes and sessions of songs included on the album, including an unused saxophone solo on God Only Knows. Bruce Johnston uncredited until Wild Honey. Bruce Johnston joined the band in 1965 and started performing on albums as early as Summer Days and Summer Nights. However, he was not credited until Wild Honey and did not appear on any of the album covers he was uncredited on. This is because when Bruce joined the band, he was signed to a contract with Columbia Records, a rival company of Capitol Records, so he was not allowed to be credited on albums or be seen in promotional images with the band. His contract with Columbia likely expired sometime in 1967, making him able to partner with Capitol and start being credited for his work on the albums. Spanish chorus on I Just Wasn't Made For These Times. During the chorus of I Just Wasn't Made For These Times, there are four different phrases being sung layered on top of each other. They are, "Sometimes I feel very sad, ain't found the right thing that I can put my heart and soul into, people I know don't want to be where I'm at, and O quando sere, un dia sere," which translates to, "When will I be? One day I will be." It's hard to hear all these phrases when listening to the full mix of the song, so it's almost like a little Easter egg for listeners who listen closely. Deirdre and Earthbound. Deirdre opens with the soft, whispery harmony of the word Deirdre. This is sampled in the song Cave of the Past from the Earthbound soundtrack, which is a creepy song made up entirely of pitched down and layered versions of the sample. The sample was also used in Amalgam from the Undertale soundtrack. I actually first heard the song Deirdre because of Earthbound as a kid. Mike's lawsuits with Brian. Mike has sued Brian numerous times over the years. The most famous case is in the 90s, when Mike sued Brian over songwriting credits, claiming he was not credited for many songs he co-wrote with Brian and lost out on royalties because of it. Some of these credits were actually valid, such as California Girls and Good Vibrations, as he did write most of the lyrics to those songs, but others, maybe not so much, such as him getting credit on Wouldn't It Be Nice for contributing 5 words at the very end. He also sued Brian for defamation in 1992 over Mike's portrayal in Brian's autobiography, and again in 2004 over promotion of the Brian Wilson Presents Smile album. Stolen and missing masters. Many Beach Boys recordings and masters have unfortunately gone missing over the years, with the most noteworthy ones being the Smile recordings, such as the original Good Vibrations master, and multi-tracks for My Only Sunshine, Wonderful, and Cabin Essence. These were likely either destroyed or left behind at Capitol Records. Welp, that was the first half of the Beach Boys Iceberg. If you found this interesting or learned something new, please consider hitting that like button and subscribe so you don't miss the second half. If you really want to support me, please consider checking out my music, which is playing in the background right now. It's posted to my other channel, Gabe Gilliland Music, and one of these end card videos should be the song that's playing right now. If I made any mistakes or missed anything in an entry, please let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching.